Penguin Random House Audio presents Becoming Wise, an inquiry into the mystery and art of living. This is the author, Krista Tippett. Chapter 1. Introduction. The Age of Us. I'm a person who listens for a living. I listen for wisdom and beauty and for voices not shouting to be heard. This book chronicles some of what I've learned in what has become a conversation across time and generations, across disciplines and denominations. This adventure began as the century turned and has grown and evolved along with it. My interest in these pages is on qualities of the art of living that have taken me by surprise, uprooting my assumptions. I've tried in what follows to show how my ideas have emerged conversationally through a back and forth with graceful minds and lives. I've come to understand the cumulative dialogue of my work as a kind of cartography of wisdom about our emerging world. This book is a map in words to important territory we are all on now together. It's a collection of pointers that treat the margins as seriously as the noisy center. For change has always happened in the margins across human history, and it's happening there now. Seismic shifts in common life, as in geophysical reality, begin in spaces and cracks. This daunting and wondrous century is throwing open basic questions the 20th century thought it had answered. Our questions are intimate and civilizational all at once, definitions of when life begins and when death happens, of the meaning of marriage and family and identity, of our relationship to the natural world, of our relationship to technology, and our relationships through technology. The internet in its infancy is upending the nature of making and leading and learning and belonging. It's sending us into a new reformation, but this time of all of our institutions at once, political, educational, economic, and religious. The interesting and challenging thing about this moment is that we know the old forms aren't working, but we can't yet see what the new forms will be. We are making them up in real time. We're even reimagining time. Humanity first looked inside with global sweep in what is sometimes called the Axial Age, a handful of centuries mid-millennium before the Common Era. In utterly disconnected cultures, in another world of upheaval, Confucius was born in China, the Buddha sought enlightenment, Plato and Aristotle examined life and mind and soul, and the Hebrew prophets began to pen a people of God into being. The cultivation of inner life arose in interplay with the startling proposition that the well-being of others beyond kin and tribe, the stranger, the orphan, the outcast, was linked to one's own. Humanity gave voice to the questions that have animated religion and philosophy ever since. What does it mean to be human? What matters in a life? What matters in a death? How to be of service to each other and the world? These questions are being reborn, reframed, in our age of interdependence with far-flung strangers. The question of what it means to be human is now inextricable from the question of who we are to each other. We have riches of knowledge and insight, of tools both tangible and spiritual, to rise to this calling. We watch our technologies becoming more intelligent and speculate imaginatively about their potential to become conscious. All the while, we have it in us to become wise. Wisdom leavens intelligence and ennobles consciousness and advances evolution itself. Religious and spiritual traditions have borne wisdom across time, though in charged cultural spaces, they can become parodies of themselves. When I speak of these things, I'm speaking of places where we pay essential humanity an attention unmatched in our other disciplines. Our capacities to love and take joy, our capacities to damage and deceive, the inevitability of failure and finitude, the longing to be of service. I love the deep savvy about hope that religion tends, its reverence for the undervalued virtue of beauty, its seriousness about the common human experience of mystery. Our spiritual lives are where we reckon head-on with the mystery of ourselves and the mystery of each other. We tried to retire mystery in the West in the last few hundred years and enshrined reality's sharp edges instead. Solutions and plans and ideologies, communism and fascism and imperialism, with capitalism shape-shifting among them. In our somewhat chastened age, we're circling back to the underlying reality that was there all along. The human condition, in all its mess and glory, remains the ground on which all of our ambitions flourish or crash. The adage that he who does not know history is doomed to repeat it doesn't go far enough. History always repeats itself until we honestly and searchingly know ourselves. Now the chaos of global economies points at human agency. So increasingly does the chaos of the weather. Terrorism, the only ism left swaggering in the post-Cold War world, hinges on raw human despair all around. I think a great deal about a moral equation Einstein made that is as radical in its way as his mathematical equations, if far less famous. He began his life with a profound faith in the social good of the scientific enterprise, a community of cosmic endeavor that should transcend tribal rivalries and national boundaries. Then he watched German science hand itself over to fascism. He watched chemists and physicists become creators of weapons of mass destruction. He said that science in his generation had become like a razor blade in the hands of a three-year-old. He began to see figures such as Gandhi and Moses, Jesus and Buddha, and St. Francis of Assisi as geniuses in the art of living. He proposed that their qualities of spiritual genius were more necessary to the future of human dignity, security, and joy than objective knowledge. My work has shown me that spiritual geniuses of the everyday are everywhere. They are in the margins and do not have publicists. They are below the radar, which is broken. The discourse of our common life inclines towards despair. In my field of journalism, where we presume to write the first draft of history, we summon our deepest critical capacities for investigating what is inadequate, corrupt, catastrophic, and failing. The news is defined as the extraordinary events of the day, but it is most often translated as the extraordinarily terrible events of the day. And in an immersive 24/7 news cycle, we internalize the deluge of bad news as the norm, the real truth of who we are and what we're up against as a species. But our world is abundant with beauty and courage and grace. I'm aware of a growing aspiration to attend with all the tools we have at hand to the human change that makes social change possible. The digital world, though a new Wild West in many ways, is on some basic level simply another screen on which we project the excesses and possibilities of life in flesh and blood. Spiritual life is evolving, and its sources of nourishment are becoming more broadly accessible. Science is yielding knowledge of our bodies and brains that is an everyday form of power for softening the gap between who we are and who we want to be as individuals and as a species. Across social and medical disciplines, we are gathering a radical new understanding of the nature of human vitality and wholeness. We create transformative, resilient new realities by becoming transformed, resilient people. This is about the lover as well as the beloved, the citizen as well as the politician, the social entrepreneur as well as the person in need. It means me and it means you. Listening is about being present, not just about being quiet. I meet others with the life I've lived, not just with my questions. I've learned along the way to be grateful for the unlikely trajectory my life has taken, the perspective it's granted. It's given me intimate familiarity with some margins that are in fact the heartbeat of a society and access to places where power is exercised, the power of idea and the power of action. I have been afforded a sense of long arcs of history that infuse what we perceive to be crises of the moment, where we came from and how we got here from there. I was born in the wee hours of the night as the 1960 election returns came in and John F. Kennedy was elected president. I grew up in Shawnee, Oklahoma, a small town in a young state in the middle of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.